The next speaker is Professor Wilbert IJzerman. He currently is Manager Technology Innovation at Philips Lighting. And since 2014, he's also part-time full professor of illumination optics at our university. He joined Philips Research after his PhD in Applied Mathematics of the Twente University of Technology. And in 2008, he moved from Philips Research to Philips Lighting, first as a venture manager and later again in different management functions, but all within advanced development. Now, his research interest has always been on illumination optics, and in his presentation, he will explain his view on where this field of expertise will be heading to.
Thank you.
So, and that apparently is just a long enough introduction to get Wilbert fully installed. Yeah. So, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Ingrid, for the kind introduction. Okay, welcome. I will tell you about the advances in illumination optics. This is really the core of lighting, I think. It's about where to bring the light. Yeah, we can talk about all these intelligent cities and all the connectivity, but still we have to bring light to our customers. Yeah, and that's one of the topics that we look into in this program. Of course, I don't do this alone. There are six PhD students involved, three people from the university, Jan ten Tijer Boomkamp, Jörg Beckers and Sander Nijdam. So we have a team. And I would like to present today the different topics that we address in this research. So it's a presentation that goes from partial differential equations to experimental setup in vacuum. Yeah, so it's quite broad, but I think it gives a flavor of what we do. I cannot go in all details. That have only half an hour. So if you want to know more, you have either to come to the poster presentations or to ask me later on. Yeah. The outline is that I first want to tell you what is illumination optics, because you might not know. And I will give you briefly an introduction to the physical phenomena that are involved. Then I will go into detail into what is the workhorse of optical design, which is Monte Carlo simulation. And this method has a few advantages and a few disadvantages. And we try to solve a few of those in three different program lines. Thereafter, I would like to discuss scattering and how we characterize optical components. And then I will round off, hopefully, in time. So to start with, what is illumination optics? In LED lighting, we use LEDs. And you might not be aware of, at least many people talk about LEDs, but you have never seen one. Yeah, these are LEDs. So you can see it's very bright. Of course, you have also different colors that are involved. And light is going in all directions. So either you are blinded because it's too bright, you don't get the right light at the right position, and therefore we need optics. And I have here a few optical components. This is a huge one, not used in many products, but it's easier to see. Most likely they are smaller in real applications. And you put these on top of the LEDs to create a certain light distribution. Yeah? And that's where it is about. How do these kind of components look like and what do they do? Now, you see here an example, a spot on the upper left, a cross-section on the upper right. I will come to that in a few minutes. Typically, a component like this. And on the lower right, you see a high-end luminaire, also a spotlighting used in high-end retail or home lighting, and an exploded view on the lower right. And you can see the exploded view is not a single component. There are many components involved. So it's about lenses, reflectors, diffuse elements, etc. Now, what is the physical phenomena that we use? Just a brief recap, because most of you have seen this, I think, during secondary school. It's about reflection, yeah? The thing that happens every morning when you stand in front of the mirror to do your hair or to shave yourself. It's about refraction, what happens in front of your eyes if you're wearing glasses, and even happening in your eye. Light is going from an optical less dense medium to a denser medium, or vice versa. And bends, it's the interface, so that's refraction. And in some cases, there cannot be reflection, and we have total internal reflection. Yeah, that are a few of the basic phenomena. And the other one is scattering. And we encounter scattering every day. When we have a nice cloudy day, you see the sun scattering on the clouds. But scattering is very important, and let me try to illustrate that. It's always a bit risky, of course, to do an experiment, but okay. This is a white LED, way too bright to look into, not very nice. And typically what we do, we hide those behind diffusers. And I've here a few samples of diffusers, going from a relatively mild mild hiding power, as we call it, to a very high hiding power. And if you put an LED behind the mild hiding power, yeah, you can still see the LED is still annoying, so that's not nice. So we have to do a little bit more, and if you put it behind the one that has a high hiding power, you see it's a nice uniform white surface. At least I hope you can see that. Yeah? Because I see the backside, and at the backside there's also a lot of light. So the one who has a lot of hiding power is also throwing a lot of light back towards the LED, which means it's not a very efficient solution to do that. The nice thing is, both situations we understand quite well. This is a very thin diffuser, hardly any diffusivity involved. That one we can describe very well. It's a simple linear ansatz, basically. This one is high diffusivity, so we can describe it as a diffuse equation. That's also well known. But in illumination optics, we want to be just in between. We want to have the hiding power, basically, of this one, but the throughput of this one. And that means we are just in between the two limits, and that means physics doesn't know how to describe that. Yeah? And that's one of the areas of research that we are in. Now, why do we study illumination optics? Illumination optics is a very old field. I mean, it's known for more than 100 years that you need mirrors, lenses, etc., to create a light distribution. Well, we study this because, first of all, LEDs are relatively cold sources. They don't get that hot as, for instance, incandescent bulb gets. And you know this because if an incandescent bulb breaks and you have to replace it, if you try to take it out of the luminaire, you have to wait a few minutes because otherwise you will burn your fingers. Yeah? So this high temperature needs optical materials that can withstand that temperature, which are typically glass and metal. Yeah? But LEDs are not that hot, so we can use plastic. And plastic has way more design freedoms. So to utilize these, we need good tools and to understand how to do that. Another reason is that we have a surplus of computational power today. So we can calculate everything, so we can make virtual designs. We can avoid hardware iterations. That saves a lot of money, a lot of time, and gives us speed. But still, we need good tools to be able to make good predictions. And I will show you that's not that easy. And then, last but not least, things are getting digital. In the sense that we see that multiple LEDs are being used in applications. So you have to think about, how do I create a light distribution? A good example, I think, is car headlighting today. I think we did this in 2008, 2009, where we used multiple LEDs to create a car headlight, which could turn off part of the beam so that you don't blind the one who's coming towards you. Yeah? Now, these things you see today in the market happening. Another example is colored light. With the introduction of connectivity, colored light starts to be important. If you want to have colored light, you don't want to have colored shadows. Now, to avoid colored shadows, you need optics to mix light, and you need to do this in a clever way because it needs to be efficient, and still you don't want to have these colored edges on your spot, for instance. Yeah? So that's a little bit the background why we do this. The workhorse of most optical designers is Monte Carlo ray tracing in illumination optics. What is it? Now, if you take that spot, then I've shown here a cross-section of the optical element that's in. So I have here the LED, this is air, and then here I have a plastic material, plastic component. So I have sidewalls, I have a reflective surface and a top surface. Light starts at the LED, goes to, for instance, the sidewall, is refracted at that position, then reflected on the reflector surface by total internal reflection, that is very efficient, and then refracted again on the top surface. If you want to design such a component, you make a certain geometry in a CAD tool, and you start to trace rays from the LED at certain positions and certain directions through the system and see how it arrives at the detector. And on the detector, you count in bins how many rays arrive there. And this profile, this bar plot, gives you the light distribution. Now, the nasty thing of this procedure is that it is a random procedure. So you have to choose randomly where to start and at which direction from the source. And that makes that it's not very efficient, and that's illustrated here. If you look to the error that you make as function of the number of rays, it converts as 1 over the square root of the number of rays, which means that if you want to improve your efficacy, your error by a factor of 10, so reduce it by a factor of 10, you have to increase the number of rays typically by a factor of 100. Yeah, and that's of course not very nice, because that makes it slow. And we know many examples in daily practice where we overlooked our features in beams because we had small features that were not visible in the noise of the Monte Carlo simulation. And especially colored features are difficult to see. Yeah? So we need tools to do that better. Now, I will talk about 3 different ways to approach that, to solve this issue. The first one is using phase space. Let's try to explain that. If you have this system, I just explained to you, with the source and here the optical component and the refraction, reflection and refraction in the optical system. Yeah, that's actually, this is the component, a little bit enlarged and unfortunately rotated by 90 degrees. But I assume you could handle the 90 degrees rotation. Yeah, the rest might be difficult, but this should be doable. If you then look to the rays that start here at the source, there are, for instance, rays that only start at the source, go through this lens part, and then go to the top surface. And I think it's hardly visible, but there's a yellow ray here in the middle. So if you look to the collection of positions and angles starting from the source that go only through this central lens, that are all these positions. So here's the position on the source, here's the angle. So this is the phase space, basically, position and angle on the source. So this is a certain region. Then there's also a region which is noted here with 4, which are actually the rays that go start from the source, go through a small flat area here, and then go to the top surface. And there are some regions 2 and 3 here, which are the rays that go via the sidewalls, via the reflector to the top surface. Now, so there are different regions. If you would do Monte Carlo, your rays would be spread evenly on this space. So they would be all over the place. And what actually is the important thing is, where are these boundaries? Because their array suddenly goes from one position to another position. Now, that's shown here in this figure. If you look to, this is the position on the source, where array starts under which angle. This is a picture of the position and the angle at which it arrives on the detector, which is just above the top plane. So you can see that the regions are really split and shifted around. Yeah? If you know this structure, you can use it. So if you know the boundaries, and that's the thing that you would like to know, if you can detect those, and we've developed tools for that, yeah, it's relatively easy and relatively fast that you can calculate the light distribution. How does it look like? Now, here you see the light distribution, so the reference and the phase space analysis are just on top of each other, at least by eye. If you look to the error, you see this is the Monte Carlo error, behaves as 1 over the square root of n, so 100 times more arrays if you want to be 10 times more accurate. Our methods behaves as 1 over n, so 10 times more arrays if you want to be 10 times more accurate. So that's quite an interesting game. What you also notice is that we need less rays, but I have to say, of course, in our method there is some overhead involved. Yeah? So we are looking into how much gain is there and how can we improve that still. But it's an interesting method, I think. Another approach would be not to do it with ray tracing. So as said, ray tracing, we start with rays on a source. These are 2 reflectors and we arrive somewhere on a detector and we make bars and that's our intensity distribution. Yeah? The nice thing is you can calculate rays very accurate, up to square root of machine precision, typically. Yeah? But you lose precision because you use binning. Yeah? Another way to do it would be to use it to see it as a system where energy flows from the source to the target and look to a more flow type of approach, a fluid dynamics type of approach, where we take the energy flowing with the rays towards the target. Now, this means you don't have to do ray tracing, so it's a little bit less accurate in this sense, but it's more accurate in the energy distribution. And to give you a very simple first example, we have here 2 materials of 2 index of refractions, and we go with our energy distribution starting at this Z0 plane, and we move up. So this is the initial discretization. There's a different index of refraction. That's why here the angles, which are denoted by P, is a larger angle than the position. And then let's see if we can get it running. So this is a simulation where we show how the energy is moving. Yeah. So you see here the energy moving from one domain to the other. So it's moving from one material to the other. You see change of angle and you see also a reflection back in the system. And the reflection back is the total internal reflection. Now this is a first attempt to escape from ray tracing. This is a very difficult attempt, I have to say, at least we have to think very hard. And the reason is that in practice it's a 4-dimensional system. You have 2 angles and 2 position coordinates. So we need to discretize in a 4-dimensional space the whole system. And for that reason, you need to think about how do I do that? Because if you take a normal discretization, you are losing speed because of the huge number of points that you need. Yeah, so we have to do with a few points, we have to do the discretization. Now, we are working on a lot of tricks to do that, but I think this is a good example of a different approach. Then a completely different approach, not simulating forward. It means so far I've talked about a geometry that you have, I have a source, and I go through the system and calculate what the distribution is. You could also approach it inversely. and that's called inverse method. I give you the source light distribution, I give you the target distribution that I would like to have, and the question that I need to solve is how should the mirror or the lens look like that does the job? Yeah? So let's take an example system. We have two mirrors, reflector 1 and reflector 2. We have a source, which we assume to be, for instance, uniform. All rays are leaving parallel from the source, so again, it's a model system in that respect. And they arrive parallel on the target. And the question is now, if you give me the source distribution and you give me the target distribution, can you calculate the reflectors? Yeah? This is a well-known problem, but it's difficult to solve. It's related to building a sand castle. Yeah? So if you think we are playing, indeed sometimes we are playing with sand in this respect, with mathematics. If you build a sand castle, you have a pile of sand, and you have to decide which part of the pile of sand goes to which part of your castle. Yeah? Do you take the left part of your sand pile and bring it to the left part of your castle, or do you bring it to the right part of your castle? Yeah? What is at least involved is conservation of mass, or conservation of sand, if you do it right. Yeah? So you start with a certain amount of sand, and you end up with a certain amount of sand. Of course, there's also cost involved. Yeah? It's your energy that you put in it, or the sweat that you put in it. Yeah? In an optical system, it's the same. We have a ray starting somewhere, and that has to be transferred to another position. And that involves cost. And there is conservation of energy. I start with a certain amount of energy in my source, I arrive with a certain amount of energy on my target. Yeah? Now, this problem is known for more than 200 years. It's called mass transport problem. It's known for more than 200 years that this problem has a solution. It's only known in the last 10 years how to find the solution. Yeah? And that's what we work on. It's called the Monge-Ampère equation. We have shown it many times before, I think in the past. And here I show you an example of this two-mirror system. So here I have two mirrors, uniform source, and a certain target. And I already show you here two solutions. Yeah? And that's already a hint, there's not a unique solution. There is a unique convex and concave solution. I don't want to go into details. There are even two other solutions that we can find where we cannot prove that they are unique, but we can find those. And there might be many more. And optical designers, by the way, know there are many more because by construction, I can make many more. Yeah? So the question is also, how do you find those? Now, here's here two examples of calculations. These are the target distributions that we aimed at. So this is the target we have here with a uniform source here. And this is the resulting picture if we have calculated the mirrors and then do ray tracing to find the picture back. Yeah? And as you can see, it resembles quite well the target. You see all kinds of nice small features that are in the target distribution, also in the one that we get finally after the whole computation. So the method works very well, yeah? But still a lot of things to do. Now, as said, there's cost involved. Every optical system comes with its own cost function. And here are 10, you can call them archetype of optical systems. For 8 out of those 10, we know how the cost looks like today. Yeah, we didn't publish yet, but we know more or less how it looks like. 2 out of 10, we don't know. Yeah? And our method only works for quadratic cost functions, and many of those are not quadratic. They have a different shape. Yeah? So we still need to work on the algorithm that can also deal with different cost functions. And we have a clue how to do that, but I think it will cost us another PhD student to manage to do that. Yeah? It's a lot of work. Then scattering. I told you with the samples, we have a small amount of scattering, thick plates, a lot of scattering, and we are somewhere in between. Now, to understand scattering, we are doing an experiment. And the initial idea was we take a cloud, a dust cloud, and we shine on it with a laser, and then we look what kind of light comes back. Yeah? And that might give us information about the scattering of the cloud, about the multiple scattering and the interaction therein. So we started with a very simple experiment. We take a single particle, and it is hanging in a void space of a plasma, but that's not important, that's a stable position, so the particle can stay there for many, many hours, even days, if necessary. And that makes it a very nice environment experiment. So we have here a small particle, because it's a tiny particle, which is actually hanging in such a system. We shine on it with a laser, and then we have a detector that can rotate around the particle. Yeah? And at every position, we can measure the amount of light coming back from the particle. Now, this is a textbook example. This is called Mie scattering. So we expected to see Mie scattering. Yeah? What you see here is the intensity distribution that you obtain as function of angle. And this gray bar is because there are some pillars somewhere in the construction where we cannot measure. So we exclude those of the analysis. Now, then if you look over time, and this we went around 5 times, and you can imagine a single particle size 2 micron, there's not that much light coming from it, so for signal-to-noise ratios, you have to measure quite a long time. Yeah. So measurement is hours here, this is in minutes, 400 minutes. We went 5 times around, but every time we find a different curve. It doesn't look the same. So apparently something is happening with the particle. Yeah, this was a thing that we didn't expect. If you then look to the analysis and we take the 5 samples, one of the things that we noticed was that in the void, the particle was not hanging at the same position. It was moving up. It was an indication it was losing mass. Yeah? If we add that to our analysis, we find that the particle is reducing size by approximately 2 nanometers per minute. So somehow our particle is shrinking in time. Yeah? We don't understand the phenomena yet. It's something that we suddenly encountered. We were not expecting to see that. Most likely related to either ion bombardment or chemical interactions in the vacuum system. But it's the next step that we will make is use different gases and different materials to find out what's really happening there. But we can explain that. That is an unexpected phenomenon. What we also can do, so this was destroying the particle basically, we can also grow particles in the same system. Yeah? And the idea is, if we take a lot of small particles, which is basically dust, and put it on a sample, can we not make a dedicated scatterer? Can we play with the scatter properties? Yeah? And that's not necessarily we should make round particles, we can also start with some initiation particles like nanofibers and grow those in the system. Yeah? And then we hope we can make diffuse elements which have certain new properties. So it's an explorative topic. Now here you see the setup in preparation. I think it's a little bit further today, close to being in operation. And then we can do the first experiments. Now, it's all nice, but if you have all these nice design tools and we make these kind of optical components, the question is how to characterize those. And there are many techniques for that, but all with their advantages and disadvantages. And we came across a technique that we are exploring, and it's called plasma jets or plasma bullets. And the phenomenon is the following. I have here a small needle, and if I apply high voltage across that needle, I get a gas discharge that's visible in this movie. So we have here the small needle, and you see the gas discharge occurring here. The funny thing is, the gas discharge is moving from left to right at a speed of 100,000 to 1,000,000 meters per second. So it's quite fast. Yeah? You cannot reach that with your car or your bike, for sure. What the phenomenon is, we have a plasma surface here, so we have charged particles here. They create a very strong electrical field, and in this electrical field, electrons are pulled from the atoms to this positively charged part, and then the boundary moves to the right. And this process continues, and it's a stable process. Yeah? The funny thing is, these bullets always follow more or less the same path. If you look to this video, you will see that over time, if it moves from left to right, the path is nice and straight, but then suddenly at the end, it's going in all directions. Yeah? It's a little bit like a lightning. It's also going in all directions. But the first part is stable, and the question is why? Well, first experiments have shown us that most likely there are some either electrons or ions still in the path. And because it's a channel where there is some charge still, so the plasma bullet has a preference to stay in that path. Yeah? Now, if that's the case, then with simple electrodes, we would be able to steer the path as well. Because if there are ions or electrons, we can move them around. So we should be able to move around the bullet such that we can also scan components to see by time of flight what the size is. Yeah? So that's the idea. Now, to really do that, we also need to know how the electrical field around the plasma bullet is. Because if it comes close to a surface, the interaction between that electrical field and that surface will create a current, and that's most likely what we will measure. Now, and to characterize the electrical field, we need quite complicated setup, I have to say. So we use Raman spectroscopy for that. And I don't want to go in all the details, but it is a multiphoton nonlinear process. That's all that you need to remember. So we shoot with 2 lasers and have the plasma bullet going through the laser beam. And from the signals coming from that laser, which are different frequencies, we can calculate the electrical field. Now, we have done first experiments in Germany with that. That shows us that indeed we get a very nice resemblance between the measurement that we have and the calculations that are done in Amsterdam. So we can match the models with the experiment. That's very nice. Yeah. But it only tells us something. In the peak of the in the center of the plasma bullet, on the sides there's also electric field, and we have to estimate that. So that's not that nice, and that's why we have built a new setup. You see a sketch here. And that's also close to be in operation, and then we can measure really also the tilts of the plasma bullet and can tell way more about this phenomenon. Now, after this being told, what is the future? Now, one of the things that we were happy to receive, and I think it's good to tell here as well, is we got the confirmation last week that we can start with an STW perspective program on scattering and free shape. I've shown here the graph that we use. So it's about this kind of shapes, all kinds of strange optical components, and the combination of scattering. Scattering is a phenomenon that takes place on the nanometer scale. It's about small particles, random paths of light in a system. Freeform is about things of the millimeter size. Those two worlds are scientifically completely separated. They have nothing in common. But we see a lot of components and a lot of systems that use these phenomena. And to give you a few examples, we use it in bulbs. This envelope is a diffuse envelope, and the thickness of the envelope and the curvature is chosen in such a way that we get the right light distribution, which is prescribed by regulations. Yeah? But we don't know how to design this. Actually, there are only a few people in Philips that can do that, experienced designers, and they make this design, and then we can use it. But if someone else has to, if I had to do it, I don't know how to start even. Yeah? It's complicated. Another example of the same application is a satellite. The trend is to go to microsatellites to be able to monitor much more areas. Satellites use the sun for calibration in many cases. So if they're just above the Earth, the sun is just hitting the satellite, they measure the amount of light coming from the sun and use that as calibration. To be able to calibrate, they use a diffuser. But the diffuser is spreading light all around in the system. So they need large bevels, optical components, large tunnels, basically, to take care that they don't have all this light in their instruments, because that will destroy either the instrument or will take care of temperature shift in the instrument and ruin the calibration. Another example where you encounter scattering and also free form is in a measurement of wafers at ASML. So we now made a little bit for an illumination institute going to the detour. But they see the same problem. Markers on the wafer are hidden underneath diffuse layers. Yeah? And with the technique to understand scattering, yeah, we can also look partly through diffusers. And if you can do that, you can see the markers better. Yeah? So it's a coherent set of problems that we try to solve in this program. So to round off, I've already talked about, I think, most of it and told you what we would like to do in the near future. It's from the Monte Carlo part, in many cases, it's improving the tools. We have first evidence that some of the methods that we are working on give an improvement. But in many cases, it's only 2D. So we have to extend it to 3D. We have to extend it to real-life cases instead of model cases. Yeah? So that's a lot of work that needs to be done there. The inverse problem, I think, is a very important part of the project. It's very difficult. We can do it for a few sample systems, only for quadratic norms, and that's only a subset of the problems. So also that is quite some work still to do. Now, and then scattering, we just scratch the surface of scattering. Scattering is very difficult to describe, very difficult to understand, and that, I think, is a very new, interesting field of research. And then the combination of freeform and scattering. Yeah, we have already seen in first experiments that scatterers are behaving differently if you make them freeform. So all the physical descriptions are always on a flat substrate with infinite boundaries. And if you do a real diffuser and you make it a little bit curved, yeah, we see that all the optical path lengths are different than we would expect from theory. So there's indeed indication that this is an interesting field. Well, and that concludes my presentation.